Vendor Parts Synthesis, or VPS, was developed to solve a tedious problem that affects all RF designers when they start to build the actual RF PCB board representing the optimized design schematic of your amplifiers, oscillators, or filters. Here, you need to account for the finite available values of vendor RLC components, the parasitics, and the physical effects of the additional metal traces needed to connect these components together. You may also need to know if the choice of component tolerances is tight enough to produce acceptable yield of the PCB in production. Until VPS, this is a tedious trial and error manual process, which can take days with suboptimal results because it is almost impossible to test all possible combination of the nearest up or down discrete component values. Now let's see how to do this in just a few minutes. As an example of a circuit that we need to build, let's create a 5th-order 2 GHz low-pass filter using the Genesys Passive Filter Synthesis tool. I'll choose a design with minimum inductors because inductors cost more than capacitors. Now let's use VPS to help us select actual vendor RLC parts to build this filter. I'll start VPS from the Synthesis menu. VPS automatically looks for the linear analysis of your design schematic from the workspace tree to use as the reference specs for the actual circuit we're building. It then creates a new VPS schematic and performs a comparative simulation using the closest available discrete RLC values from the 10% tolerant E-series. E-series are a sequence of nominal RLC values with tolerance spread that do not overlap. That gives you an idea of how far off from your original specs just by picking the closest discrete value parts. Refer to Genesys help to learn more about E-series if you're curious. The VPS selected parts are indicated by the small VPS symbol next to it. However, E-series do not include component parasitics. For that, VPS needs vendor parts from the Monolithics library. A free subset library called Monolithics Select is included with Genesys, and it is selected by default in the Configure Libraries tab. Next, we'll need to choose the default tolerance, body styles, and vendor part families to use for the capacitors, inductors, and resistors. I'll choose the Chemet CBR06 capacitors and Coilcraft 0603HP inductor part families. As you select a part family, the info box below indicates the body style and purchasable discrete values. Choose a part family that covers the range and steps of component values you need by comparing it to the original E-series values found by VPS in the tune window. And hitting apply will prompt you to specify a substrate material if you haven't done so, because the Monolithics Parasitics models, Momentum EM, and microstrip circuit simulation are substrate dependent. The mapping tab allows you to overwrite the default RLC part families chosen earlier for each component in your design. Individual component mapping may be useful, for example, if you want VPS to use the original real value capacitor because it is part of a transistor model or an inductor implemented with a coil. The impact of each component change is instantly reflected in the comparative VPS simulation traces as shown. By switching between the ideal original and the actual part, you can quickly gain insights on components that are more sensitive to change, which in this case are the capacitors, and you may want to tighten the tolerance for purchase. Next, the Layout tab can help you automatically insert short sections of microstrip lines to interconnect the solder pads of the SMT components and account for the effects of these extra microstrip layout by creating an EM circuit co-simulation analysis. Hitting the Apply button also creates a new VPS schematic containing the closest vendor part values, with additional short sections of microstrip interconnects and junction discontinuities. A comparative circuit simulation is performed, and you can see the rather severe shift downward of about 500 MHz to the cutoff frequency from the original reference. This is due to component parasitics and the additional microstrip interconnects. The complete circuit layout is also automatically created, including the variable solder pad sizes associated with each SMT component body style. To more accurately include the effects of layout and solder pads over circuit simulation, a momentum EM analysis can be performed, and the results combined with the circuit parasitic models of the LC components in a VPS momentum coseam linear simulation. We can see even further deviation from the original reference filter performance. You can specify the default width and length of the microstrip interconnects here. Next, let's use the Optimization tab to quickly set up optimization goals to restore the filter response. Unlike traditional brute force discrete optimization, VPS performs a more efficient two-step optimization. First, with fast continuous optimization, followed by a grid search of the nearest up or down discrete values. By default, the grid optimization is set to search one step up and one step down from the continuous optimized value, and you can see the total number of grid searches increases rapidly with each grid step increment. Hitting the Apply button brings up the optimization goal wizard, which allows you to quickly define typical low-pass, high-pass, band-pass, and band-stop response of filters and amplifiers. I'll choose a low pass and set the transmission stop band goal to be 20 dB. VPS Goal Wizard intelligently identifies the frequency at and above which 20 dB stop band rejection occurs in the original reference design and defines the stop band slope goal region as shown. Now we are ready to launch the optimization by hitting the Optimize button. You can see in the optimization status window that a gradient or pattern search is used initially to find the starting values for the grid search. At the end of the VPS optimization, the bill of materials is updated to reflect the list of vendor components you need to purchase. But wait, you may want to know what's the yield of the filter by using the selected 10% tolerance parts. Let's do a quick yield analysis here with just two clicks and running the VPS yield analysis from the workspace tree. Here, we see that we get only 30% yield, which is unacceptable. Let's tighten the tolerance to 5% for each component and see if the yield improves. Now we get a more acceptable 74% yield. Before we go ahead and build this filter, let's compare the component values found by VPS with the original ideal values. The capacitors C1 and C3 at 1 picofarad are 46% of the original 1.865 picofarad. The center capacitor C2 at 1.5 picofarad is less than half of the original 3.212 picofarad. The actual inductor value are 35% lower at 3.6 nanohenry versus 5.575 nanohenry. These set of actual values would probably have taken multiple manual trial and error to discover because they're not expected. Let's go ahead and build two of these filters to see if VPS works. And here it is in a single pass using the components in the VPS bill of materials. We build and measure the response of the filters and overlay them on top of our Monte Carlo simulation. To achieve results like this in a few minutes versus days of manual vendor part selection with uncertain yield, use VPS for preparing your next PCB build and have fun. Thanks for watching.